Luke didn't just write the Gospel of Luke, he also wrote the book of Acts. These two books are the only books with a Gentile author in the Bible. More so than the first two synoptic Gospels, Luke deals with the Holy Spirit and what role the Holy Spirit played in the bigger picture of Christ coming to earth and starting the ripple effect we are still feeling to this day. Regardless of what you think about the Bible or Jesus, something happened in the first century that was pretty major, and the literature regarding those events is the foundation for Western society. 50 days after Christ is said to have ascended, he promised, and it happened, the Pentecost arrives. This is God's Spirit delivered. This is the Sophia and Prudence promised in Ephesians 1 by St. Paul. And you'll remember Luke traveled with Paul. There are synchronicities in their teachings for a reason. They were close and friendly. Now, this is the Gnosis, or the Gnostic Awakening. This is could be seen as just a Pentecostal illumination. So Gnosis has less to do with the New Age wooification propaganda suggests, and is simply the mystery of God's will abounding towards us in Sophia and Prudence, as in Ephesians 1. And this is a spirit that illuminates the hearts and minds of men 50 days after Christ has ascended. Some theologians have suggested that it was the Pentecost that actually kick-started the movement. The Christians were in hiding and were scattered, and the Pentecost created a bit of a coagula. So there was some salve. Now we see the Spirit of God moving. Think of water, you know, like liquid and solid in the form of ice, but also a vapor. And now imagine a kind of electric water, like a kind of mysterious substrate through which these other forms are held together and supported. And in this way, the ineffable God can divide itself and experience itself and also represent itself in different forms. Hence the avatar of Christ being God, but in a diminished human form. But Christ was the divine vehicle for and the announcement of the coming of the Pentecost, of the Holy Spirit, of a universal Gnostic awakening and an illumination. And so we see in the COVID masks and in the vengeance and hatred and fear porn of the media coming from many different ideological angles, a kind of anti-Pentecostal imagery. In John 20:22, Christ breathes the Holy Spirit on the disciples. The breath, ruach in Hebrew, and pneuma in Greek, the wind, the breath. This is an invisible fire ether, a substrate to everything. And it goes all the way back to the book of Genesis, where many Christians don't know, we see the introduction of the Holy Spirit. So this isn't a New Testament idea. It goes right back to the beginning of creation.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters.
So right out the gate in the Hebrew, we have Ruach in Genesis 1, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, God as Spirit, God as Creator, God as Son. So we have the Father, the Son, the Spirit coming from the one ineffable source. The breath moves. We can see it move the trees. The trees react. We don't know where the breath comes from. This is poetic imagery, but I believe this hovering over the face of the waters is not just poetic language, but like much of the language of the Bible, is embedded with esoteric science. So hovering over the face of the water could be the electrons in the covalent circle hovering over the inner circles and the nucleus of the atom. So we have the atom getting broken up and adjusted in the book of Genesis, symbolically in the garden, refers to the nature of human beings and the human condition, but I also believe it has atomic information. And this goes right back to biophotons, melanin, and information in the water. We literally get this through osmosis. When Moses goes down into Oz in Egypt, he learns the ways of the Pharaoh moans and the hormones, as well as other types of inspiration that are more divine, like the nature of genius.
Pen and ink for writing. It's all done again. Last night I was with him. He told me about his father, who had died. But Moses wouldn't believe it.
No, listen.
He said, if they dug his father's body up, he would be gone. They planted a seed over his grave. The seed became a tree. Moses said his father became a part of that tree. And when a sparrow ate the tree's fruit, his father flew with the birds. He said, death was his father's road to awe. That's what he called it. I've been trying to write the last chapter, and I haven't been able to get that out of my head.
Why are you doing this?
I'm not afraid anymore, Tommy.
Let's take a look at the symbol throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament. Breath is the vehicle and symbol for God's Spirit. And the gathering, the real church, it's not a structure, it's a group of people coming together. The breath and the gatherings are literally being made illegal across the world.
Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld."
I've suggested in some of my previous teachings that hating and loving something are, to a degree, forms of worship in and of the same, and we are imbuing things with a co-creative faculty most of us are unaware of. We are changing the world as we perceive it, and our perceptions are being disoriented by external stimuli that would have us believe there's a plague spreading across the world, and the right thing to do is to rush out into the street and seek vengeance. Symbolically, we see angry people and people without any breath. From the "I can't breathe" to the people wearing masks, this is a mythopoetic symbol for anti-Pentecost, and the Pentecostal illumination is Gnosis itself. The Gnostic reclamation is a Pentecostal illumination, a coming new balance that happens from the inside out as promised by Christ and Saint Paul. Ephesians 1, the mystery of God's will is abounding towards us in Sophia and prudence. Things will be explained, not by me, on a personal one-on-one level with God. And COVID masks and Hobbesian nightmare, ideological wars and superheroes bent on a lust for vengeance, they can't stop the truth. And there isn't a single barcode or vaccine that can ever excommunicate you from God's love. So don't listen to the fake Christians on YouTube pushing the fear. That's the plague. That's the mark itself.
I'm coming down for you to where you've gone to. I'm coming down for you as you always knew. you to pull in close when danger was near. All your tender parts exposed out there in the clear. But when you come down hard, as you always do, I'm saving a part of me just to come down for you. I'm coming down for you to where you fall. As you always knew I would. On the plains where the burn has gone, scarred the locusts and the ogres, all the flowers and the birds sang on, the ashes and the smoke. Scorched lungs, you call to me. Sound the echo straight through. Up the canyons and the valleys, I'll call back to you. I'm coming down for you to where you fall. I'm coming down for you, as you always do.